Good morning, church. Welcome to worship. My name is Todd Jordan. I serve as senior pastor here at Strawbridge United Methodist Church, and a very special and warm welcome to all of you. We're delighted that you are here on this gorgeous Sunday morning. If you're visiting with us, a special welcome to you. If you are worshiping with us online, a special welcome to you as well. Isn't it amazing that the God of creation, of the universe, infinite, in all possible dimensions, would be here present in this room with us, as close to us as the breath that we breathe, drawing us close together, closer to God, closer to one another. Wherever you're worshiping with us, God is present in our midst. What a glorious privilege and gift it is to be here in worship this morning. And so as we take a deep breath and give ourselves over to this moment, knowing that God is present, and we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship, I'm going to invite Adelai, Villella, to come up and get us started in our call to worship this morning. Adelai, Villella.
Please stand and join me in our call to worship. The world belongs to the Lord, the earth and all its people. How good and lovely it is to live together in unity. Love and faith come together. Justice and peace join hands. If the Lord's disciples keep silent, these stones would shout out loud. Lord, open our lips, and all our mouths will proclaim your praise.
Together our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Join me in a spirit of prayer. Lord of dawn and darkness, how grateful we are for your loving mercies. You saw our fear and doubt, our suspicion, our mistrust, and you banished them from our lives, replacing them with hope, peace, love, and joy. You called us to be your witnesses to all the world, unafraid of what others might think or say about us. We have been invited out of our darkened hideaways and into the light of your world as emissaries of hope and justice, peace and compassion. Be with us as we participate in ministries of healing and hope through this church, in our community, region, nation, and world. Give us courage and strength to be your disciples in all the circumstances of our lives. When we are blinded by anger, pour out your love for all to see. When we wonder what tomorrow will bring, call us to trust in you. When sadness fills our lives, plant gladness in our hearts. God of Easter, touch us with your grace. You show us your hands, so we may reach out to mend the broken. You show us your feet, so we may walk with those who the world passes by. You show us your face, so that we may know what our sisters and brothers look like. Risen Christ, touch us with your compassion. You open your eyes so we may see God's love. You open our minds so we may welcome God's word. You open our lips so we may be God's witnesses. Spirit of hope, touch us with your peace. God in community, holy in one, open us to your presence as we pray as Jesus has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You haven't had your donuts already this morning? Yeah, some of you have. It's kind of, have you ever been afraid? Have you been afraid before? Never? Wow. When were you afraid? This is not confession time, but I'm just curious. When have you been afraid or scared or worried? On Friday night when it's storming? Yes. My puppy dog would agree. Sometimes you have monsters under your bed. That does happen. But it feels like it. No chance of monsters. Good. Woo! you've seen a snake before in your home, in your house? Or it could happen. Okay, it could happen. So when have you been afraid? The first day of school. Yeah, it's scary the first day of school. You're unsure. Ugh, spider webs. Yep, don't, I get it. Yeah, we don't need spider webs, do we? And then a couple more. Tell me. A mosquito on your neck. Yep, that's pretty frightening. You really had a snake in your house. All right, close us out, Mr. Cato. Close us out. When were you afraid? Fall off into the beach. Sometimes you're up, so heights make us scared, afraid. Well, today we are on our first Sunday. We're on the first Sunday. Oh, you have a question? But okay, tell me. A bee being on your shorts or skin. That would make me afraid too. Well, guess what today? Lily, guess what today? You can tell me in just a second. The disciples, Jesus is what? His followers, his companions, his friends, they're feeling afraid, but they're feeling terrified. Can you make a terrified face? Maybe yawning. Okay. We're not really sure. So being terrified is mean like they're extremely afraid. They have extreme fear. They're really unsure of what's happening. So I want you to see a video this morning about my scripture that we're going to talk about. And the disciples are what? They're terrified. So let's check it out.
In that hour, they made their way back to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and the others who were with them and told them their story. As they were telling their story, Jesus was suddenly standing among them.
Well, that's not what happened.
Yep.
Everyone was frightened and thought he was a ghost.
Okay, come on, guys.
But Jesus showed that it was really him. He showed them his hands and feet, and they all watched him in awe. Then Jesus asked for something to eat.
Oh, got anything to eat?
And they gave him fish to eat.
Oh, that's good.
Jesus reminded them that everything happened as it was supposed to, and helped them understand the scriptures. Then he promised to send them the Holy Spirit, and told them to stay in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit would come and fill them with the power from heaven.
So why were they frightened? What had happened to Jesus? He had what? He died on the cross and had risen, and did they know that? Well, they kind of did. Did you know that? There were some reports that Jesus was alive, but if you had seen someone die on the cross, would you believe they were alive? Maybe, I'm kind of a mixed bag here. So that's why they were frightened. They're like, Jesus, they thought he was a ghost. If you saw a ghost, you'd be pretty terrified too. But guess what? When they were afraid, what did Jesus do? Did he say, you shouldn't be afraid? What did he say to them? He said, repeat after me. He said, peace be with you. He's saying, it's okay. I know you're afraid, but I am here with you and you can trust in me. And that's what Jesus wants us to always remember, that we have spider webs in our wagons or snakes in our house. We can always remember those four words. Say it with me, peace be with you. And you can have calm hearts. So when we go past the peace this morning and just about, or I'll be on your skin, yes, or I'll be on your skin, I want you to go tell someone that you don't know this morning, peace be with you. What are you going to tell them? All right, let's pray. God, we are thankful for these children this morning. We're thankful that they got up this morning, had their donuts, put on their clothes, and joined us in worship this morning with their precious families. Lord, remind us as we walk this earth and we walk through our everyday, the four simple words, peace be with you, and being reminded that you're always with us. We love you, God. And all of God's children say what? Amen. Church, I invite you to stand and pass the peace of Christ, and you share peace be with you with a neighbor this morning.
Peace be with you.
Gospel reading this morning.
Our gospel reading this morning will be found in Luke 24, beginning with verse 36. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Started hanging with the outcasts when he went off to town. Some called him a troublemaker. Even some say a lawbreaker. No matter how they talked about him, he never let nobody down. 'Cause that's just the way he was raised. When people started to gossip, he just walked away. He always loved his neighbor, no matter what they say. Oh, that's just the way he was raised. On a cross, on a hill, that long-haired boy was killed. All our sins washed away when he walked out of that grave. Oh, that's just the way he was raised. There's no way we can measure the sacrifice he made. He knew he had to die, but I did too. Pain. Well, that's just the way he was raised. It took the hand of God to roll the stone away. And that's just the way he was raised. And that's just the way he was raised.
I feel like I need to preach after that. Thank you guys so much. Amazing job. Will you pray with me? Most holy and gracious God, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the sunshine that you've given us this morning. And God, as we enter into our time of the message, may my words be for your glory and your honor. Thank you, God, for Strawbridge and the ways in which you have continued to work every day in our lives. We love you, God. Amen. Haley Arsenault was born and grew up in St. Francisville, Louisiana, just, I think, northwest, if I have my Louisiana directions right, of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. She was your active fifth grader, 10-year-old, who loved all sports, especially taekwondo. I know we have some taekwondo kiddos in our presence this morning. Well, during one of her many practice sessions or lessons, she started developing a minor pain in her leg and wasn't too concerned, neither were her parents, because many 10-year-olds have pain in their legs, right? When you love sports and dance. And so they just weren't really concerned. So they gave her an ACE bandage, and she was thrilled to wear that to school because she thought that would look really cool with her friends. But as time progressed, she noticed that the pain kind of got a little worse. One side of the leg was warmer than the other, and noticed not long after a small lump above the right knee. And so the family decided maybe a doctor's visit was in hand. Well, as you might have inferred, an unexpected diagnosis came of osteosarcoma, bone cancer of the right leg. At 10 years old, I'm sure you can imagine how upsetting and life-changing that was for sweet Haley. Feelings for the big C, for cancer, was a death sentence in her sweet brain. And as you can imagine, life continued to change. Fortunately, she was admitted to St. Jude's Children's Hospital in Memphis. And on the plane ride over, she looked at her mom and said, "Mom, I am terrified. I don't know if things are gonna be okay. Does God not like me? Does God hate me?" And she said, the mama responded very sweetly, "No way, Haley, God loves you." So have you ever been terrified? This feeling of extreme fear, unsure of where to turn next, or wondering and questioning, where are you, God, in the midst of all of what is going on? Maybe you can resonate with Haley this morning and her experience at 10 years of age, or maybe how our disciples you have heard on the video are terrified this morning in the Gospel of Luke. Today we do find ourselves on the other side of the resurrection, and the disciples are feeling just a little terrified. They are huddled behind locked doors, afraid authorities might come after them, and at the same time struggling and dealing with the reports that Jesus had been seen. Suddenly behind these locked doors, Jesus appears in their midst. Now even more terrified because they think they are seeing a ghost. Nothing could have prepared the disciples when Jesus suddenly appeared, but who could blame them? They witnessed the death of Jesus, and even though they had reports from the women and those on the road to Emmaus, fear of course would be their natural response, as it would be for you and for me. Thankfully, Jesus spoke these four simple words to them. Very first, the disciples, "Peace be with you." These four words spoken by Jesus were indeed a gift. And that gift was that Jesus met them, the disciples, exactly where they were, offered no judgment for their fears. Jesus gives them opportunity to touch and see, and even, as you know, asked them for something to eat. Jesus asked for broiled fish and ate right in front of them. And I don't know about you, the ghosts that we know do not partake in breakfast, lunch, or dinner. Now there's another gift that Jesus offers the disciples, and we can find that in our verse in our scripture this morning, of course, in the verses 44 through 48. We're going to pull back that this morning, and I'm going to share it with you again. "Then he said to them, 'These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled.' Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, 'Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in the name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. The gift Jesus offered was this. He opened the disciples' minds to the fact that death is not the final word, that they are set free from the bonds, and now are to become witnesses for him. There is no way I can begin to fathom the emotional journey that the disciples have been on or had been on. But what a gift it was for them on this day to have Jesus suddenly appear in a time of panic and struggle, to have their fears assured, not judged, minds opened, and then to be commissioned to go out and preach the gospel. And as I've read this passage many, many times, read commentaries and the notes in the bottom of my Bible, I think the grandest takeaway from this story is this, is that Jesus called the disciples to take a risk, to come out from behind the locked doors they were behind, and to be his witnesses. I think the story would be different for us today as his children if Jesus had not begun his encounter by saying, "Peace be with you." Those four simple words changed their hearts and should do that same for you and I today. The disciples came to understand that Jesus had conquered it all, death itself, and that their fears were groundless. Church, Jesus calls us to do the same, to embrace these four words every day, "Peace be with you," and not allow fears to hold us captive. On days where my fears, and I'm sure many of you have heard this verse from Pastor Beth, she shares Proverbs 3 with me many times. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not rely on your own insight. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your ways." And he will make straight your paths. I even have that printed in my car to remember each day. Dorothy Soll was born in Germany in 1929. And during her growing up years, Hitler and the Nazi regime was in full force. Dorothy is known for her writings and reflections during the time in concentration camps and life after World War II. Her writings challenged our human tendencies, or the human tendencies, for wanting to feel safe and secure from any threat by seeking that from God. In her book, Essential Writings, she offers several essays on this topic. In one essay called "Peace, Not Security," Dorothy shares these words: "Change happens at the level of action that contains risk." In another essay, "Jesus' Death," she writes, "Because you are strong in Christ, you can put the neurotic need for security behind you. You do not need to defend your life like a lunatic. For the love of the poor," Jesus says, "you can give your life away and spread it around." So what does this look like for us today in this 21st century to embrace "Peace be with you," and in some ways let go of this sense of security? Rest assured, I'm not preaching that we should take all the locks off our doors or go into downtown Houston at 3 a.m. ready to preach the gospel. Rather, I'm asking, how can we let go of the security that makes us comfortable and offer "Peace be with you" in a world that most desperately needs to hear those four words, "Peace be with you"? Two American women, Susan Reddick and Patty Quigley, can help us understand what this means. On September 11th, 2003, both women lost their husbands in the terrorist attacks. Susan was 7 months pregnant with her third child, and Patty was 8 months pregnant with her second child. Both, reeling from their losses, began to feel a stir in their hearts for Afghani women and started a foundation called Beyond the 11th. This humanitarian organization partners with international aid groups to provide job trainings and economic opportunities to Afghan widows. See, when Afghani women lose their husbands, they lose all rights and find themselves at the bottom of that society. They can be evicted from their homes, children taken away to live with in-laws, and then could possibly be forced to live on the streets. So the skills they learn from the programs offered is key to their survival. If you go on their website, beyondthe11th.org, you will read a simple goal that they set for themselves:
to help just one. As you can imagine, this organization has helped a little more than one. It's helped thousands, not just widows, but also their children. The ladies have traveled to Afghanistan to meet the widows, as you see here, and have shared the connections they have made, has helped them make sense of the world. Graduates of the program have started businesses like raising and selling eggs, selling milk from the dairy cows they manage, creating and selling embroidered textiles, hand-stitching soccer balls sold around the world, and on and on. These simple businesses have sustained their families. And as one woman shared, this program released me from seclusion. Susan and Patty meet these women right where they are, with no judgment, and offer them the peace and love that only Christ can give. They modeled for us what it means to be God's witnesses, to take fear and loss and allow God to transform their grieving hearts. God and the amazing work that God does shined a light on a group of women who needed to know that they are loved and that they mattered in this world. Barbara Brown Taylor shares these words about these women. Reclaiming the ancient practice of hospitality for the stranger may lead us to our true home where all can be at peace. They, Susan and Patty, model for us the gift of open and understanding minds and hearts. Today, we do live in a world of violence, poverty, prejudice, fear, isolation, neglect, and more. The light of God does not always shine very brightly. And despite our well-intended efforts to help make the light shine brighter, the pain, suffering, and injustice remains. God still gives us a calling to be witnesses for Him, to bring about peace, love, compassion, and grace. The assurance of Jesus' resurrection reminds us that God is alive and working in our communities and throughout the world. It may be dark at times, but remember this, the sun always comes up, even when it's cloudy. Our scripture today does challenge us as a body of Christ. It challenges us to answer questions like, who in our community needs to hear the four simple words, peace be with you? And if we're called to be God's witnesses, what do we need to let go of in order to be fully present with Him? These are huge questions to ask. And so I invite you today, this week, maybe in a minute out the altar, to ask this risen Christ to make Himself known to you, both in large and small ways. I want to assure all of you, and this is for me also, that God's presence is always among us in everything that we do. Do not miss out on being a witness for God. Don't allow any of your circumstances to prevent you from offering peace, love, compassion, and hospitality to a stranger. It is amazing how when we step outside our own needs, we quickly realize the amazing work that God does. Philippians 2, 1 through 5 says this. If then there is any comfort in Christ, any consolation from love, any partnership in the Spirit, any tender affection and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or empty conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Now, when we left Sweet Haley at the beginning of the sermon, she was terrified, like the disciples, by her cancer diagnosis and was asking and begging the question, why me? Why is this happening? During her cancer journey, Haley received a year of intensive chemo and received a titanium prosthesis inside her leg that gave her the gift of walking. She also formed close bonds with her team, her medical team, and earned the title Gratitude Administrator for the love that she shared with guests and patients as they entered the hospital. Haley quotes, "It was wonderful to be around supportive adults because it helped me focus on something that was beyond my own sickness and my own pain. They really encouraged me helped me to find purpose. I was able to give back and to show gratitude of just feeling like the sick one. In 2021, many, many years after she beat cancer, Haley took a job at St. Jude's Children's Hospital, just as she had promised her team. And it was during that year that the hospital wanted to change her life a little bit more for her. Funds were raised by the hospital to make a mission to space. Accepting this life-changing offer, she began 6 months of several types of trainings in order for her to have an experience of a lifetime. So on September 15th, 2021, with four other crew members, Haley, as you can see on the screen, boarded the aircraft and orbited the Earth and became the youngest American and the first pediatric cancer survivor to ever orbit the Earth. She shared that on the day she had no fear, just pure joy and excitement. The fear she once had from her cancer treatment and journey and the fears she had during problems she had with her prosthesis were gone. And said the first time she saw Earth from space, she was frozen and was stunned by the beauty of the Earth, blown away by the vibrant and brilliant colors that God gave us. Haley describes her experience in this way. And looking at it, of course, makes you think about how God created this planet. And I felt very close to him. It deepened my faith and helped me see this purpose he had for my life. Church, one thing that we can always expect from God is that his goodness will always be greater than our fears. Peace be with you this morning, church. Now it is your turn to go share those words with someone who needs to know they matter. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As our ushers are coming forward to receive our morning gifts, won't you pray with me? Gracious and holy God, we are indeed grateful for this beautiful gift of creation and the gift of life, the gift of new life. We pray, O God, that our generosity may always have us labeled as gratitude administrator, and we pray that you would remind us that your grace is always greater than our fear as we offer our gifts to you in worship. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Troubles.
Gracious and holy God, we thank you for this opportunity to return back to you a small portion of which you've already given to us in abundance. We simply ask that you would receive these gifts, bless them, multiply them, send them into the world for the building of your kingdom, that you may be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Whenever we gather for worship, it is an opportunity to receive the word and respond to the word. And if you sense God calling you to respond in some way, I invite you to let us know and have a conversation about that. If you're visiting with us and ready to deepen your level of commitment to God through membership of our church, you may come forward this morning and join our church. Simply fill out the blue membership card and bring it forward. If you are worshiping with us online and want to know more about what it means to follow Christ or be a part of the Strawbridge United Methodist Church community, I invite you to call me or email, and I'd love to have a conversation with you about that. Or if you want to come up and simply pray, the prayer rail is open as well as we remain standing to sing our closing hymn, Because He Lives. Among us and within us. What an awesome gift. I invite you to be seated. We have a few folks who would like to join our church this morning. Amen. We have Savannah. Oh, y'all can clap too. You don't have to, but it's okay. It is all to God's glory. We have Savannah Noakes, who is transferring from another Methodist church. Adam and Deborah and their five children, Elliot, Mackenzie, Allie, Claire, and Weston, to be a part of our church community. They're transferring from another denomination, but they know our church pretty well, and they know what they're getting into. And then Debbie Dean, who is transferring from another Methodist church as well. We are delighted to have you part of our community as members of Christ's Universal Church. I'll simply ask, will you be loyal to the Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, answer, I will. And as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, answer, I will. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to invite Pastor Emily to escort you into the narthex so everyone can tell you just how delighted they are that you have joined our congregation this morning. Remember, it is no small thing to be greeted warmly with a smile, with a handshake. For those of you that know what that feels like, how warm it feels to be received into a church, I invite you to extend that same warmth and hospitality to our new members, any new faces that you may see around you, and to everyone. So I know you're asking, okay, Todd, we're now a part of this United Methodist Church community at Strawbridge. Now what? I'm glad you asked. We have so many opportunities to plug into ministries of the church. One, there is a new Sunday school class forming today. So if you're not part of a Sunday school class, there is a new one starting in the choir room. You go out these doors and turn to the left. Choir room's at the end of the hall. So that's starting up. Also, there is a new Methodism class starting up Tuesday night. It's a four-week class, Methodism 101. For anyone who is new to Strawbridge or new to Methodism or maybe even new to Christianity, you want to know more about why we do, what we do, and how we do it, join me starting this Tuesday night at 7 in the Great Hall. If you don't know where the Great Hall is, find someone with a name tag. They'll be happy to show you where that is, along with the coffee and the donuts on the way. This Wednesday night, a six-week Bible study is beginning at 6:30 p.m. in room 151. 151 is right down the hallway, so that's Wednesday nights at 6:30. And also, for all of you women, we have several circles beginning United Women of Faith. United Women of Faith, formerly known as UMW, United Methodist Women. We are beginning several new circles, I think like 7 or 8 of them. I mean, there are just several of them. So you want to know more about United Women in Faith here at Strawbridge. United Women of Faith, our members are committed to inclusivity, action, and impact as women of power and passion, united by God's love and our mission to help women, children, and youth. We have our new unit is made up of several circles, and at Strawbridge, those circles offer every woman a place to plug in and serve. Every circle within the unit has a community connection. All information is at a table in the narthex this morning. Our current board members are at the table, ready to answer questions and help you find a place to serve. And where is Carol Bowden? Are you here? There she is. There's Carol Bowden. If you have any questions about United Women in Faith, follow Carol to the table in the narthex. We have a lot of opportunities to serve children and students in our church for the spring and the summer and the year ahead. If you're doing that, we need you to be safe sanctuary trained to help make sure that we're keeping everybody safe. There's a safe sanctuary training. Is this afternoon the 16th? Okay, this afternoon at 12:15. Also, if you can't make it this afternoon, that's okay. On April 23rd at 12:15 and May 7th at 12:15, just as a reminder, for Safe Sanctuary qualifications, you do need to attend the training. We need you to take a background check and to complete the Ministry Safe online. And just so you know, I do it, all our clergy do it, all of our volunteers do it. We're all participating to help keep our children safe. So thank you for that. And men, don't feel left out. If you are a man and you sing, our men's chorus is singing in church on the 30th. So if you want to sing, join the Wednesday, you can come to choir Wednesday night at 7:30, and you can just show up for this one-time thing, and if you want to stay and be part of the choir, that you can do that as well. So there are so many new opportunities for discipleship, ways to get plugged in. If you're overwhelmed, confused about anything, just send me an email. I'll be happy to have a conversation with you about ways that you can get plugged in. Thank you for all the ways that you are trusting that God's grace is greater than our fears. Won't you please stand now for our blessing and dismissal? Did I get everything? Okay. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. And the church boldly proclaimed, Amen.